All right, hi, I'm Tom Martell with Channel Fireball, bringing you a sealed deck here with Born of the Gods, the new set that just got released today, fresh out of the pre-release. We're going to do three packs of Theros and three packs of Born of the Gods, like you would at a GP or at a PTQ, and let's crack some packs and see what we have. Always the most fun part of any sealed deck tournament is getting open packs and seeing what kind of goodies you can pull. Here we have a foil and a rare. I always check the rare first, and Temple of Deceit, not very exciting, but... good mana fixing if you end up wanting to, you know, splash something or you're those colors. And here we can see, geez, another foil and another temple. This case, Temple of Enlightenment. So getting some good mana here for an Esper deck. And the foil, there's a Divination, which will go right with it. Now we break the cycle. No temple, no foil, but a Hammer of Purphoros, which is certainly a powerful card. Unfortunately, it's in red. And red is definitely the worst color in this block. So that is a little bit too bad. Here we can see another red rare, Satyr Fire Dancer. That one's not all that exciting, but we'll get to that when we start building. And now here we can see an Agent of Fades. That's a very powerful card. For those of you who've played a lot of Theros, you're probably already familiar with it. It can do a lot of work at killing off your opponent's creatures. And finally, we have a Guild, which is, I think, also quite good. It's one of the new removal spells in Born of the Gods. But now that we have the cards all open, let's go ahead and sort by color. Kind of the homework, if you will, before you get to build your deck. And what I'm going to do once I get these sorted, I'm going to go through each color and kind of pull out all the cards that are not so hot. The first pass, I'm going to be pretty aggressive, separating into kind of three piles. I'm going to pull out into the cards that are obviously playable or that are good, into the marginal cards that might be a 22nd or 23rd card if you really need to fill out your deck, and then pull out the cards that I under no circumstances will I ever be playing. And once you've done that, you can pretty quickly figure out which colors are open to you and what your options are going to be for how to build your sealed pool. And what I'm going to be looking for in my kind of main card color is a kind of good creature base with a solid mana curve. And then we look for also while I'm doing this for cards that are worth splashing. So single cost, colored costing cards that are good on the splash are great for that. And then finally going to look for kind of what bombs I have that are maybe require a color commitment so I know what colors I'm biased towards when I'm going to be doing my build. Just take a glance through the gold cards here. We can see we have a Battlewise Hoplite and Fanatic of Xenagos and Cure's Follower are all quite good. Well, Spellheart Chimera is pretty bad. So we're going to go ahead and put that one. If we end up being blue-red, maybe we'll play it if we have a lot of spells, but we don't want to play that card. But all these other gold guys are quite good. Next, we'll move actually over to the artifacts. Gorgon's Head, a new card from Born of the Gods. It's an equipment that gives the equipped creature Death Touch. Not great because it doesn't boost the stats of the creature at all. It's only really going to be useful when you're putting it on a guy who's blocking someone bigger. So you're never going to get card advantage out of this card. So it's really not the kind of thing you're looking to play in your deck. So that's the Witch's Eye as well, also pretty bad. Bronze Sables, filler. So I'm going to put it actually right here with the Spellheart Chimera. We'll go back to that if we end up needing to fill out our deck with a 2-drop, but not excited to play that card by any stretch. And then going through our white cards, I'm going to pass through and see what's actually unplayable here. Starting with this Afara's Radiance. If we end up having a lot of Inspire guys, we really need a way to tap our creatures. I could see playing this card, but it's something I'm not going to look to have in my deck. And that's two copies of that, the only ones I'm really going to pull out at this stage. Everyone else, which we'll get to, we're going to leave in. Looking here at green now, flipping through, new card Mortal's Resolve. This card's fine. It giving your creature indestructible and +1/+1 means your guy will always survive a removal spell. Also, will survive combat, so it's certainly a reasonable trick. See, target creature gets +X/+X until end of turn, X is your devotion to green. Aspect of Hydra obviously requires you to have some green permanents on the board, but it has some upside if you have a lot of green mana symbols. Not super exciting, but I think the card's certainly going to be playable. So we're going to keep going here. Not seeing anything here that's especially bad. Defend the Hearth, we can cut that one without too much concern. Everyone else here looks like it's going to make it past the first pruning. Under red, which is the worst color in Theros. Satyr Fire Dancer is a rare from the new set. Whenever an instant or sorcery spell you control deals damage to an opponent, Satyr Fire Dancer deals that much damage to target creature that player controls. So you have to be trying to burn them out. This is way too situational. Not something you're going to want to have in a limited, so we're going to go ahead and cut that guy. Seeing a decent amount of burn here. Going to cut our messenger speed. But yeah, a lot of ways to deal damage. Here we have Bolt of Kranos, which is another Lightning Bolt variant. So red actually has a lot of removal. Searing Blood, another removal spell. Scouring Sands, which is a tremor, deals 1 damage each creature your opponent controls. You get to scry for 1, so it's potentially a fringe playable. I'm actually cut that for right now, but we might come back and pull it in. But it's much more of a sideboard card in some matchups where they have a lot of one toughness creatures. Gonna go to black, which is our largest pile of cards. That's promising. Hopefully, we have it's pretty deep, and we have, you know, four gray merchants, and we can build the black deck. And here we're seeing, so far, all this stuff is playable. And again, we'll come back and look through this when we start laying it out. But everything here is passing the test. The Shrike Harpy. This is the new tribute black uncommon, flying tribute two. Whenever tribute isn't played, that you edict them. Otherwise, it's a 4/4 flyer for five. That card's pretty good. So we have a Dark Betrayal, which we're going to pull out because that's a sideboard card. But otherwise, all the black cards look actually pretty good. So I'm excited to dig into the black. And then in blue, seeing here, we have the blue uncommon tribute guy as well, which is great. The blue here looks quite good. So Evanescent Intellect, which is the Inspire Enabler in blue, mills them for three. That's not really a card you want to be playing in sealed unless you're really built around mill, which this set doesn't really support. So I'm going to go ahead and cut that card. But otherwise, all of our blue cards actually look good too. Three copies of Divination, so a lot of card advantage in our blue deck. So we'll be good at grinding people out. And just reminding myself, my gold cards have a blue, white, and a blue, green guy, as well as red, green. So the red, green one, I can't imagine it being red, green, but we'll come back and cut that soon. So now where do we go from here? We've kind of pruned all of our colors. And I want to start kind of laying out a shell or a skeleton to see what might fit together well. When I went through blue, I noticed a lot of flyers. And so I'm actually going to start by laying out my blue creatures and see how that mana cove lurks, because I thought there was a lot of potential with all the flying and all these divinations. I think it's like a great place to start. So we actually have two copies of the blue tribute flyer, which is either a mind control or a 4/4 flyer for five. So that card's going to be quite good, I suspect. A couple coastline chimeras, which are good defensive creatures. Vortex Elemental, which is another new card from Born of the Gods. It's a 0/1 that lets you shuffle it and anyone it's blocking into your library. I think that's certainly a reasonable blue card in terms of removal. Two Chorus of the Tides, which is a 3/2 flyer for four with Heroic that lets you scry when it gets targeted. And then one copy of a Null as well as another playable. So looking here at blue, laid out like this, we can see again three copies of Divination. Those cards are going to be pretty good and sealed. Ways to gain card advantage. The faster the format is, maybe the little bit worse Divination will get because you won't have time to spend an entire turn just drawing some cards. But I'd be surprised in this format if you don't want to play at least a couple copies. Maybe you don't want all three. I could see cutting the third, but I think it's a good start. Other things worth noting here, nothing to trigger Heroic whatsoever, so no real good ways to target our own creatures. We don't have any bestow creatures. So, for instance, our Chorus of the Tides aren't going to get Heroic out of our blue, but if we pair them with another color that has a lot of target effects, maybe we can take advantage of those. So I'm going to pause here. I'm going to move on to the next color, but this is a very good curve. You know, two drops, three divinations you can play on turn three, and then some really good flyers as our high end. And you know, getting eight flyers in out of one color is awesome. So I'm very excited about the blue. I think it's going to be a good shell for a deck. But let's just keep looking at each color one at a time, and then we'll start seeing what synergizes with together. Also worth noting is we have two blue Scrylands, right? Those two temples that we had opened. So those can both go into our blue deck, making our draws a little bit smoother. Looking at black, I guess his black's ended up being pretty good as well. Black's very deep. We didn't really cut a lot here. But my guess is a lot of these cards will end up not making the cut if we actually end up being black. But we'll see what we're doing here. So the first thing to note, I have this Rescue from the Underworld, which is a pretty situational card. You really want to have come to play abilities to pair with it, and this deck does not have very many. We have one Grey Merchant, one Disciple of Fenax. So I suspect that Rescue is not going to make the cut in this card pool. Just don't have a lot of things to combo with it. Also, we have these two Fellhead Brawlers on turn two. They're 2/2s that can only block if you control a second Minotaur. So if our deck's going to be controlling, this card's not going to be great in it because we want to be able to trade off our 2-drop for their 2-drop, and we certainly can't do that with Fellhead Brawler. He has to attack instead. So I think he's pretty mediocre, probably on average a little bit worse than Flesh Mad Steed, which was certainly not an exciting card. From just Theros. So, looks solid here. Again, we have two Read the Bones, which, you know, given we have those three divinations, it's just a lot of that effect. We certainly are going to play five of those, but they synergize, they overlap there. But the curve here is solid. We have Guild, I think, is actually a great removal spell. Very splashable, too, only a single black. But it will let you exile any creature, and you get a gold token that lets you make a mana later of any color. So that's certainly quite a powerful card. Sip of Hemlock, also, again, unconditional removal is certainly very good and sealed. Freakish Cure is quite solid. Eye Gouge kills Cyclopses. There aren't that many whatever the plural of Cyclops is. I believe it's just Cyclops. Not a lot of those in the format, but it's certainly fine. Even if they don't have it, you might be able to kill something in combat because it goes -1/-1. Look at these other just new creatures. We have a 4/2 for four, so a giant cockroach was an old card from previous core sets. When this guy dies, put the top four cards of your library into your graveyard. That's a drawback if the game's going to go long and you worry about getting decked, but it's an advantage if you can play out of your graveyard, for instance, a card like Rescue from the Underworld. So it's something worth keeping in mind, but certainly not an exciting card. It's a very filler. Similarly, I think this Mist Marshmish Titan, who I had earlier today in my pre-release deck, also sort of filler. It's a 7-mana 4/5 with no ability. He gets cheaper the more black things you have in play, but realistically, he's never going to come out on turn 4 or turn 5. Turn 5 is probably the earliest, so you're paying 5-mana for a 4/5. Not super excited to do that. So it's okay. The Drifters are okay, but I'm not really thrilled to play either of these. Nor am I really thrilled to play these Felhide Brawlers. Agent of Fates here is not looking great. We only have one Scourge Mark, and then potentially like an Eye Gouge that would target it profitably. That's pretty disappointing, because Agent of Fates can take over the game if you have a lot of ways to target it. So if we want to play black to capitalize on the Agent of Fates, we're going to need to pair it with a color that can really take advantage and trigger the heroic on Agent. So that's worth noting here for black. We'll come back to this. I'm going to pull out the Drifters and the Marshmish Titan for now. We can come back and pull them back in if we need to, but I hopefully will not need to play them. Similarly, too, for the Felhide Brawlers, but since there are only two drops, I'm going to leave them in the pile for right now. And we can always pair them out later. Moving on to green. Lay this guy up here by curve. Green typically ends up being a little bit top-heavy. And you know, hopefully we can mitigate that a little bit, get some cheaper spells. Because again, if we remember, our blue was a lot of fours and fives, not as many cheaper cards. So we would love to see one of our colors having a lot of two drops that might pair well with it. So here we can see, that's a spell. Okay, and you'll notice again, I'm separating each color, creatures on top, spells on the bottom, so I can kind of quickly see at a glance what my curves would look like in terms of my permanence. Here we can see very few spells, but a lot of creatures, especially cross-rated at the four drop slot. Let me just flip through the kind of the new cards, so some of these I haven't seen before. So here we have a tribute guy. So this guy's a 7/7 for 5, or he's a 4/4 who gains you 4 life for 5. Both those are, the 7/7 is pretty good, and the 4/4 is certainly fine. Here we can see we have a Grave Robber Spider, which is a 2/4 reach. There's a giant spider for 4, which is perfectly fine body. But he has this great ability, if you have black mana, that can give him +X/+X until end of turn, where X is the number of creature cards in your graveyard. So this card's very good if you're black-green, and certainly still fine even if you're not. So that's a card I think it always makes the cut, but you're really excited if you can go ahead and trigger it, or pump it, and activate the ability. This guy's a 3/3 who, when he gets inspired, becomes a 4/4, so you have to get through once with your 3/3, but then you're just having a 4/4 to attack with. This is certainly, I think you'll almost always play that card. And then a 2/1 that blows up an R when it comes into play. Situational, but especially in this set with all the bestow creatures, a good card by any stretch. Our 2 drops, 2/1 Satyr-headedness, not exciting. Wasn't exciting in Triple Theros either. This Swordwise Centaur is a 3/2 for 2. Hard to cast because it's a green-green, so it's going to be pretty heavy green to reliably play it on turn 2. But if you play that guy on turn 3, he's not bad. You know, a 3/2 for 3 is not the worst thing in the world. And here we have another heroic creature, a 1/1 that becomes... gets 2+1/+1 counters when you target it, so if you have a lot of ways to trigger him, he's going to be awesome. But this deck, we only have the 2 ways, plus the Nilia's Disciple. So Nilia's Emissary, excuse me. So we don't have a ton of ways to really trigger our heroic creatures. Just like we said the same thing in blue, same thing in black. It's becoming a theme in the sealed pool. Not a lot of ways to trigger heroic. So we're going to start kind of weighing our heroic creatures a little bit lower. We do still have Nessie Nasp, Nilia's Emissary, which are both great cards from Theros. So our green has some good high-end creatures. Not a great curve and not a lot of spells. We do, though, at least have Sedge Scorpion, who's a good defensive body. So we'll come back to green. Laying out white now. Again, just kind of laying it out by casting cost to see what our curve looks like. And here we are pretty generous on the cards we left in, and white is pretty mediocre. The creatures are all filler guys, 2/2s for 2, this 3/1 guy for 3, nothing here to write home about. The spells, we have a Divine Verdict and a Destroy Target Tapped Creature, Exile Target Tapped Creature, which are both fine, but white is really, really unexciting, and I hopefully will not be playing any white cards in our deck. That'll also rule out Mr. Battlewise Hoplite, unfortunately. So we'll go ahead and put him up here. And lastly, we have the red, which we remember had a lot of removal, and actually looks like a decent number of ways to target. We see Dragon Mantle or 2, a Coordinate Assault, but no creatures basically at all. We have one red creature. So that is I'm just going to double check, see, maybe I was a little bit too aggressive in cutting something, but I really wasn't. There is just one red creature in this card pool. We do have the one red-green gold card, if we end up being red-green, who is a very good creature. But we're going to need to get a color that has 10 or 11 bodies in it, because if we're trying to get to 12 to 14 creatures, that's the bare minimum. That's going to be tough. Even if we think we're going to play all these spells, you know, Dragon Mantle wants us to have some heroic guys and requires us to have a curve. Follow the Hammer, we have to have a creature in play for it to do anything. You know, it deals damage equal to the power of our guy to their creature. So, you know, Hammer Perforce makes guys on its own, but part of the ability is it gives you other guys haste, which is pretty powerful. So we would like to have some other creatures in our deck. So red, you know, we're seeing 10 playables, maybe 11 if we're red-green, and very, very few bodies. So we're going to need to pair this with a creature-heavy color. Not the most synergistic thing with our card pool. It does have three ways to trigger heroic in the two Dragon Mantles and the Coordinated Assault, so that's worth noting. If we end up seeing, you know, really wanting heroic triggered, but none of our colors were super heroic based. Our white, for instance, you know, had nothing. So we didn't have any of the Wingsteed Riders or Phalanx Leaders that made you want to try to be heroic in sealed deck. So I think we're going to put the red aside for right now and come back to our blue. The blue is the color that impressed me the most when we first laid it out. So we'll go ahead and lay it back out. Now that I kind of a mental image, a model of what all the other colors look like, I can appreciate the blue in the context of our overall pool and see what might work well together. And here we do have a lot of bodies, right? We have a ton of creatures here. Looking at 10 pretty good guys. Potentially an 11th, if, you know, if we were blue-red and we want to come back and get the Spellheart Chimera that we'd put in our sideboard earlier. Not many spells, no way to interact. So if they play a permanent, we can't get it off the board in just blue, except for our Vortex Elemental, who is pretty fragile as being a 0-1 body and has to actually interact with it in combat to do something. So not thrilled to have no way to bounce their stuff and not be that aggressive. We do at least have two of this Mind Control guy, so we at least have two 4-4 flyers. I'm going to start with the black, actually, and see how this looks paired together. So these two Felltide Brawlers, only good if we're aggressive, but we're a little aggressive here. Lay this all out. Okay, so blue-black, which is my favorite color pairing in Triple Theros for sealed deck, just because it has like a very clear game plan, a lot of good controlling cards. Looks okay, but a little clogged at the high end up here and at the 3-drop spot in terms of the spells. We do have certainly enough creatures that this is a playable deck. Unfortunately, our Disciple of Fennec and our Grey Merchant aren't very exciting because we just don't have very many black permanents. You know, obviously, your devotion guys, you really want to be having devotion equal to 3 to 5 when you play your spells for it to really be relevant. Grey Merchant even higher, ideally. You know, if you can play Grey Merchant for 6 or 7 in the late game, that's going to win you a lot of games on its own. Here, we're never going to get that much devotion out of it. Also, our Agent of Fates can only be targeted by the Scourge Mark. And maybe this Eye Gouge, it's pretty underwhelming. These two colors don't really complement each other all that well, except for this Guild and the Sip of Hemlock with the black. Because we're going to be racing in the air with the blue spells, all the flyers, so we just want to kind of hold the ground long enough to kill them. And the black is not very defensive. So I don't think this is a great combination. I wouldn't mind maybe splashing this Guild, potentially, if we can, in another deck. But, you know, when you have 2 Read the Bones and 3 Divinations, you don't need, you know, there's just a lot of overlap in what's going on there. So let's pull the black out, because I think the black is not all that exciting. I guess let's try the green now. Let's see how this looks. So pump spells in this deck are going to be a little bit worse than they normally are, just because our plan is to avoid combat and to fly over them. And here again we have a ton of fours. Probably going to need to cut some of these Coastline Chimeras, is my guess, from this deck. So there's just too many 4-drops. And they're the worst of them. So let's look how this is. This is not great. So things I'm noticing, we don't really have any good, not enough cheap creatures. We have the Sedison Oathsworn with only 2 ways to target it, so it's basically unplayable in this deck. So I have to cut him too. So if our opponent is on the play and they just go 2-drop, 3-drop, we're going to be so far behind. Because, for instance, our Chorus of the Tides don't block very well, so we actually do kind of want these Coastline Chimeras so we don't just get run over. But at that point, we just have so many 4-drops that we need to cut some of these green 4s. And these are the kind of the most appealing parts of playing this deck. So actually, maybe If you don't play the Chimeras, at least like this guy is defensive. And this guy, I mean, you're always going to play these two. I think you always want to play Starbreakers because there's just so many auras. Maybe we look at more of like a, almost a removal spell because the body's just not very relevant. So things that concern me here, our Devotion to Green is not going to be very high, so this aspect of Hydra is not going to be very good, so I kind of want to cut that card. Our mana is going to be biased towards blue. Oops, Sphinx's Zeb was hiding down there. Biased towards blue, not towards greens, which makes the Swordwise Centaur more of a, you know, a 3-drop optimistically and probably more likely a 4 or 5-drop. No, again, we still don't have any way to interact with their board. We can't bounce their permanents. This is a perfect deck to splash a guild in, but we didn't get any of the green mana fixing. You know, we don't have a Nilius presence to let us splash easily, unfortunately. So while we do have this one Temple Deceit to play the guild, you know, we probably also need to end up playing one Swamp, which is not going to be optimal. So let's look at the red. I mean, the red, though, I mean, we can remember it only has one creature in it. And this deck really can't support just one more creature, even if we do play both these Coastline Chimeras, especially when that creature is a 5-drop. And Spellhawk Chimera is not going to be very good here, I think, but we might need to play it. So we have a 3. Let's try adding it in and see how this deck ends up looking. So this deck is not great. Yeah, we still have a hard time dealing with like large ground creatures still. Well, we do have a decent amount of removal for cheaper things. We're not killing bigger guys easily. Yeah, this deck is not particularly exciting. I mean, we have enough cards at least, so we could certainly play this. We're playing two Dragon Mantles that in a deck that's probably gonna be, you know, 10-7 with you know, maybe 7 mountains. Probably 8 mountains, I guess, because we have all these double red spells, so we can't play to 7. This deck is pretty poor, I think. But at least it can race with these flyers, and, you know, Dragon Mantle's good on an evasive creature. Just so awkward that we don't have any other bodies. I mean, I guess we can look at not playing blue. We can try looking at maybe green-black. I find it hard to imagine not playing the blue, just because we have such good late-game flyers, but let's take a look at green-black. One important thing is that, you know, always keep checking different options. Even if you think it's not going to be great, lay it out so you can take a look at it, and you might get surprised, you might forget an interaction, you might miss something. We can just dismiss at least here red-green, even if we play all three of these bad green creatures. You know, we're going to get to maybe 10 bodies here, is what we're looking at. 11, 12 creatures. Excuse me. 13 with Fanatic. I guess we can lay it out in a second. Let's lay it out now while we're talking about it. Just dismiss it and move on. The curve is kind of awkward. In playing, like, multiple copies of Dragon Mantle in a deck that doesn't have anything cheap, so the Dragon Mantles can't get cast on time. They don't help you dig for lands that way then. So this is 23 cards, but the curve is just really backloaded and creature light, so it makes like cards like Fall of the Hammer pretty mediocre. That's a body. Yeah, I do not like the look of this deck very much. Just really underpowered. I would much rather have the blue-black deck we laid out, or even the blue-red deck that we laid out than this. So let's try... Well, I guess in green-blue we have this guy at least. We forgot about him. Maybe green-blue makes sense. I'll try just black-green real quick. I think there's really no reason. The only black cards, again, we can just repeat the same analysis, but the black cards we care about are those three. Actually, these four. Good removal spells. Two Read the Bones. And then just like a bunch of black devotion cards, which just kind of make your mana bad. And no acceleration. I wish these Fellhide Brawlers were a creature that could block or trade. That'd be so much better. Can't can't see playing Eye Gouge. So yeah, this Agent of Fates isn't even very good. Just a 3-2 Death Touch for 3 that's hard to cast. This deck is just not exciting. And then we've already dismissed the white. The green-blue deck has no 3s. So I guess let's lay out blue-black one more time. Let's see. Let's just play all the best cards that we have. So we can at least play all of our, you know, removal. And our plan will just be stick a flyer, ride it to victory, kill what he plays in the meantime, I think. Don't really want these Fellhead Brawlers. Don't really want this Agent of Fates, but I think we may get stuck playing it. I've also found is the blue-black, even when it doesn't look great, ends up outperforming its appearance frequently. So hopefully we can outperform this deck a little bit because it does not look very good. I wish the black wasn't all double black. I guess we can just play. The other problem is like with these divinations, you just really want to have a play to spells you on the discard when you're on the draw. At least we can kill things that are in play. We can cut like a divination. I think Read the Bones is probably better. So we cut 2 divinations. At some point, the life loss obviously matters more. Especially if your deck's slow. But all of our cards are very similar. You know, we have a bunch of these like interchangeable 5-drop flyers. So that maybe the scry matters a little bit less than it normally otherwise would. And maybe we can go ahead and just play 1 Read the Bones and 2 divinations. Maybe we do want 3 of this effect. I wish I had like an 06 wall. That actually fit in perfectly with what we're trying to do here, which is just stall the game out a little bit in the early turns. Even like Vapor Cannon's so bad here because it can't trade or block. I'm just very afraid I'm going to get run over before I can stabilize the game. And we're not great at catching up when we're behind. If you're far enough behind, like when you play the Siren, they just make it into a 4-4 and they can just kill you through it. Or they just, you know, swap out their best guy. But if they have multiple creatures, maybe they don't care. 3, 6, 9, 10, 15, 17. So, this is like we get to cut a card or two here. I need to do one more pass, just do the cards I'd cut to see if I missed anything that maybe I end up wanting in this deck. We at least do have a Dark Betrayal for our sideboard, which is nice. We also have a Bronze Sable here, if we're worried about getting run over. But I think we have, like, with these 2 Coastline Chimeras and this, like, Insatiable Phanax, maybe we can stabilize. This deck actually really just wants, like, a Wave Crash Triton so it can block. That would be awesome. But beggars can't be choosers. Yeah, the white is just really bad. Can't see playing the white. So we assume we're going to play 18 lands here with this Temple of Deceit. I think I like the Annul. 1, 2, 3, 4. I think I'm actually going to cut this Vaporkin. Although, we're kind of a tempo deck, actually. Maybe we want Vaporkin. We just need to put pressure on them. Our goal is to kill them with flyers and just remove a couple guys to stay alive long enough to do that. But if that's the case, then I'm not sure if you want, you know, 3 divination effects. Maybe just cut divination, too. Could cut Scourge Mark, even, but I think the free black mana for our devotion is really important. This is 23. The worst card here is probably Agent of Fates, just because we have only one way to target it, which is it's just a 3-2 for 3 mana, which is not super exciting. Wouldn't mind cutting a 5-drop, because we have a lot of 5s. But let's see. Actually, this is just a 2-2 for 5. When it comes on tap, we can draw a card. This guy we can cut. He's not all that. He's just too small for his mana cost that he gets blanked too easily. You have to do a lot of work to force him through. So we just play this and we play 18 lands. Yeah, I think we just play this with 18. And then we can play the temple as an off-color scry land, I think. Well, we have so little to do in the early turns that we can play the tap land kind of for free here, I think. So I don't think it costs us a lot. And then just once more checking through this. Looks like an eye gouge. The only other thing to do, I'm pretty okay with this deck. I'm not like thrilled, but I'm not upset. I just want to take one final last look at blue-green. Since I didn't lay out the Curious Follower before, maybe that might change my opinion if I actually put it out there. So we'll just put it out there for a second. I think this deck still has the same problems. Yeah, just too many fours, not enough like cheaper stuff. Can't even play this three drop. This two drop, 3/2 is really hard to cast. Yeah, this deck is you play guys, and if they ever play a trump spell, you're just dead, and it's so easy to trump you because your curve's really bad. All right, blue black it is, and yeah, blue black 18 lands. I think both Skylands, and that's the build. Not excited about it, but. It's, you know, it's an okay deck. It can certainly win games. And hopefully we can get there with our flyers.